The River Avon flows through Bristol. It rises here, near Sherston, in Gloucestershire, just 17 miles from its mouth, as the crow flies. But the young river follows a 75-mile curved course to reach the sea. First, a gently undulating eastward course, meandering through creamy Cotswold villages, Luckington, Pinckney, and Eastern Grey, to the town of Malmesbury, then Chippenham, Laycock, Bradford-on-Avon and Bath, and finally to Bristol. Here, the Avon bypasses Bristol's historic floating harbour, but its course gives no hint of the splendours to come. At the harbour lock gates at Hotwells, the river swings sharply north to reveal an amazing scene. The hanging woods of Nightingale Valley to the south, contrasting with towering, quarry-shattered cliffs on the north side. Bristol, the city that sent out Cabot to discover the New World, is one of the unlikeliest great ports. Its seaward entrance is the Avon Gorge, a valuable botanical site and a rock-climbing resource with finger-clinging holds on forbiddingly steep limestone. It's been an intense transportation hub in the past, with a dedicated tram line into the city. There's traces of early settlements here, dating back more than 2,000 years, and more recent remnants of a fashionable Georgian spa, a summer resort with fine promenades to complement Bath's winter season. But it's the Avon that's the star. The river takes this dangerous, narrow passage with its deceptive tidal forces and spills out many miles up the Bristol Channel, the largest coastal inlet in Western Europe. This Severn estuary is an inland sea full of menacing sandbanks, bewildering navigation channels, and brimming tides that have the second highest rise and fall in the world. Just think. At Clifton, the Severn is 7 miles wide and a spring tide rises an inch every 90 seconds. And further upstream, it creates the famous Severn Bore. The Avon is at right angles to the Severn, so picks up this ferocious tide indirectly. But even so, tidal variations in the gorge are dramatic. From a trickle between grey mud banks to a broad river nearly 200 feet across in places. Yet despite the difficulty of the journey up the river, the vigour and enterprise of Bristol commerce made the trip worthwhile. And that's because, although they're treacherous, the tides allow for rapid movement in and out of Bristol. By exploiting them, ships were able to unload at a harbour with good connections to a wide region. By the early 18th century, an increasing volume of traffic and the growth in the size of ships put Bristol at a disadvantage. Each new arrival had to stop here at Pill to collect its tow at £9 a time for a 100-ton vessel. Ships were towed up and down the 8-mile gorge by teams of horses or by rowing boats. If the holds held any gunpowder, it was offloaded to the powder house, well clear of the city's crowded quays. The floor was constructed using copper, not iron, nails, in case sparks from the barrel's metal hoops ignited the explosives. Many ships came to grief, passing Horseshoe Bend, a dangerous narrow passage with very deceptive tidal forces. This radius is so tight that any ship more than 330 feet long can't negotiate it. And in 1851, notice was served on the city docks that time had run out when the 3,000-ton Demerara second only to Brunel's SS Great Britain as the world's largest ship, was hauled downstream too fast in an attempt to catch an ebbing tide. She struck the shore, slewed across the river, and was left stranded. She was towed back to harbour and largely rebuilt. The river continued to claim victims until hazards were dynamited. So the 19th century port was condemned to failure by its geography. A possible remedy was a new dock here at Sea Mills, but it was just too far from the central trading area to be popular with Bristol's merchants. Around the 1750s, it was used as a whaling station. The mammals were caught off Greenland, butchered alongside ship, and the blubber was boiled down here. A smelly process, but far enough from the city not to be a nuisance. It fell into disuse before 1800. And there's lots more industrial archaeology in the gorge. On the Somerset side is a tiny dock with room for a single barge. Quarried stone arrived on the tide and was offloaded onto a 2-foot gauge tramway leading up this incline. The stone was put to good use. Lee Court Mansion, built in 1814 for Philip John Miles, Bristol's first millionaire. He created an arboretum and discovered a rare mineral here, celestine, strontium sulfate. At the time, this was the world's main source of the mineral. So, mining got underway, and that little tramway was used to get the ore down the gorge to the dock, where it was shipped off for use in the production of fireworks and distress flares. And the gorge could provide plenty of its own stone. Quarrying began in the early 13th century with full-scale production in the 1800s. The Great Quarry was worked harshly for 50 years, and further downstream, Black Rock Quarry, Sea Walls, was eventually closed because it was reckoned to be a hazard to downswalkers on the plateau above. Most of the stone quarried here was turned into lime for fertiliser, but some stone was used locally for building. For an 18th century snuff mill, now the observatory.
There's an exciting leisure use created by those quarrymen. In the 1950s, some students at the university pioneered bold, extreme climbs on almost vertical limestone quarry faces.
They couldn't believe their good fortune. A unique chance for challenging climbing. Only 20 minutes walk from the city centre, with a tea hut at the base and an ice cream van at the top. Then a young undergraduate, Chris Bonington, climbed everyone else's route and added a few of his own. In 1957, he was the first to conquer this climb on the immense main wall, and he did it wearing plimsolls. But these sheer cliffs are unforgiving. Tony Wilmot contributed many new routes, but fell while soloing Central Gully. He was fatally injured. He was just 23. The Avon Gorge is one of the country's most historic geological sites. Just a 10-minute walk upstream takes us through 300 million years of Earth's history. The oldest rocks, sandy limestone here at Unknown Wall. Black rock and dusty dolomite at Sea Walls. The facade of Main Wall, flecked with fossilised sea creatures that provide holds and grip for climbers. The red strata here at Bridge Valley Road, distorted by the upthrust of 1,000 feet's worth of grey carboniferous limestone from the depths. And the youngest rock, thick coral oolites at the amphitheatre and the adjacent suspension bridge buttress. Massive earth movements tilted these bedding planes to their current angle. The area was uplifted by several hundred feet, and the Avon's fierce tides were given greater power to fret saw down and carve out this deep valley.
Tourists get a terrific view of the gorge from here. It was a hermit's cell in the Middle Ages and home to a gang of robbers in 1804. At that time, it could only be reached by a dangerous ledge across the cliff face.
The gang were captured in the end, frying bacon and eggs when caught. They'd sent their women off along that ledge to fetch beer. And above, William West, an artist, rented this snuff mill in 1823, converted it into a family home with a camera obscura above. And below, he dug this 200-foot passage down to the cave, and installed this spectacular viewpoint for visitors.
Brunel's iconic landmark, the Clifton Suspension Bridge. With it, he linked the banks of the gorge, enabling Clifton to be extended, and creating the leafy suburb of Lee Woods. The bridge has a disquieting history of suicide, matching that of Beachy Head.
But thankfully, this fence above the parapet now deters jumpers. Completed in 1840, at a cost of nearly £14,000, this chunky red sandstone buttress, 110 feet tall, supports the Lee Woods Tower of the bridge. In 2002, workmen renewing paving here came upon a shaft. Potholers descended and found a honeycomb of chambers, 12 vaults, some of them 35 feet high, linked by 2-foot diameter shafts. To lighten the structure and save money, Brunel had made it hollow. We're in chamber 4. Graceful stalactites hang down 6 feet from the roof. Stumpy stalagmites litter the floor. They're formed by the lime leaching down from the tower's mortar.
Clifton developed as an elegant suburb in the 18th and 19th centuries. But residents didn't want horse-drawn trams lowering the tone of these prosperous highlands. So they went for a grand solution, a rocks railway.
It was built to link Clifton with important steamer, rail and tram connections below in Hotwells. But locals objected to a lift interfering with a ruggedly grand rock face. So, bored through this solid rock is a tunnel about 500 feet long on a steep 1 2¼ incline.
The railway closed in 1934 and was adapted for some wartime uses. Our guide into its historic depths is the restoration officer of the Clifton Rocks Railway Trust, Maggie Shapland.
This is the top station. Note across the road that you have Spring House, which was the first place where the people of Clifton enjoyed the springs. And the purpose of the railway was to bring the people from the bottom up to the top to enjoy a rejuvenated spring industry. And so note behind me, you've got the new hotel and the hydropathic spa. The railway was water powered. It was built between 1891 and 1893. And there's a water tank behind us. Note also that we found an old railway lamp in the tunnel as well. We're in the top station now, and you can see there's a turnstile in front of us that we rescued from down the tunnel and winched up the stairs. The counter still turns, and we also found a plaque that was locked over the turnstile to stop people from fiddling the numbers.
During the Blitz, the safety of local residents got priority, so these parts of the railway were turned into air raid shelters.
This is shelter 3. This is the largest tunnel of its kind in the world in the Victorian time. It's 28 foot 6 deep, it's 18 foot crown floor, and it's 6 layers of bricks thick. Behind me is at its deepest at 50 feet below the ground. This particular shelter took 100 people. They only came in at night and they went back to designated spaces. Note the lino on the ledges so you wouldn't be sleeping on the concrete. Note that the concrete has been cast in situ and you can see the shuttering marks. It's still built on top of the railway lines and so you can see one of the cable pulleys underneath.
In 1941, the BBC were looking for bomb-proof premises in Bristol in case Broadcasting House in Clifton was bombed.
This is the top of the BBC section. The BBC felt very vulnerable. Bristol had been set up as the regional headquarters and they needed to have somewhere safe. They came to the railway and set up 4 rooms. This is the top floor of the bottom station. This was a water-powered railway, but unlike Lymouth and Linton water-powered railway in Devon, they did not have an endless supply of water, so they needed a gas engine to pump the water back up to the top so that water was reused. They had 2 gas engines so that one was on standby in case one broke. If you look behind me, during the war, they had to reinforce the wall and strengthen it because you've got the docks just behind you. This is the bottom station. It's exact as it was in 1934, and it's not been touched since. You note that the water tank is underneath the floor. And you'll also see that there's a water chute behind me. There's 1 water chute per car to let the water into the water tank.
And the war brought yet another use.
This is the barrage balloon section. Imperial Airways had requisitioned the Avon Gorge Hotel above. And here you will see the officers, and there was also a workshop where bits of barrage balloons still are. The barrage balloons were to stop the enemy aircraft from flying too low. This is a good place to see the railway lines still underneath all the brick structures that have been placed on top of them. This is a room just underneath Prince's Lane. And so because it was no use for protecting people, they used it as a bomb absorption area and they put all the equipment from the top station into here. You've just seen the turnstile upstairs. This is where we got the turnstile from. We had to cut a hole, which took us 10 hours to cut. You can see we've still got 2 more turnstiles here and some partitions and some valves.
In 1934, with the closure of the Bristol Port Railway's Hotwells terminus, close to the lower entrance to the tunnel, and the opening of the portway, taking away much of the traffic, the Rocks Railway closed down.
This colonnade was a rank of shops, serving the tourists who came to sample the spa waters at the Hot Well. There was a pump room attached, and the aristocracy used to enjoy carriage rides up to the Downs and boat trips across the river to Ashton for strawberry teas.
Here's the source of the Hot Well, at 60 gallons per minute and a balmy 23 degrees Celsius. It's 10 feet above low water, but it's 26 feet below high tide, so the water often got polluted. A test on the water 100 years ago revealed radioactivity 170 times higher than tap water. The Hot Well got a reputation for curing gallstones, scurvy, gout, cancer, and VD. It was originally reached by 200 steps from Clifton, so if the radioactivity didn't finish you off, the climb back up might well have done, as these gravestones in a Clifton churchyard suggest. The Hot Well was never a match for the spas of Bath or Cheltenham, and suffered a long decline. It was finished off by the final stretch of the A4 road from London, the Portway. This road thrust its way down the gorge to Sea Mills and onto Avonmouth. Opened in 1926, it took 5 years to build, and at £800,000, 100 feet wide and 5 miles long, it was probably the costliest road in the country, and certainly the finest riverside highway. In 1854, Edward Sweet, a botany lecturer, published this little book, Flora Bristoliensis.
describing 810 species found within 10 miles of the centre of Bristol. Its pages are a testament to the importance of the gorge as one of the country's foremost botanical sites.
Among the rarest species, still here today, there's bloody crane's bill, pale St. John's wort, spiked speedwell, autumn squill, and, found nowhere else in the UK, Bristol rockcress and Bristol onion. As for the rare trees, the botanist, rock climber and Avon Gorge specialist, Libby Houston, is well acquainted with them.
So Libby, what's so special about the trees here?
The Avon Gorge is extraordinary for having 21 various white bean species, or sorbus is the Latin name for the whole genus. It has basic species, rowan, common white bean, and the wild service tree, which are sexual species. They're not that common in Britain. It's got species which have evolved here in the Avon Gorge. They haven't got anywhere else in the world yet. They're here. Here's a Bristol white bean leaf. It's very smooth on the top. It's rather a subtle shade of green. Don't know what you call that, but it's, would you call it lovet green or something like that? I don't know, on the back. And its distinguishing feature is that it's widest above the middle. That's quite a crucial thing, the correct leaf when you look at it. It's quite streamlined at the base, or technical term, cuneate or wedge-shaped, but some of them look streamlined. And the Bristol white bean has notches going in like a flight of steps up the side, quite sharp points on the end. These very sort of right-angled steps. Nothing else looks exactly like that. Its parentage was round-leaved white bean, which is sometimes compared to a table tennis bat, and the wild service tree, which is up in Lee Woods. And some event caused them to hybridise and caused a species to arise, which is the Bristol white bean. It's nowhere else in the world. And I suppose there are about 300 trees of it, young ones. I've even seen a seedling, great big huge ones I can't get my arms around. So it's doing fine. It's obviously really well suited to this place. So there's no worries about it.
So what makes the Avon Gorge such a unique habitat?
Well, back in 2004, there was a project to find out how many Bristol white beams there were. So various people set out in various parts of the Avon Gorge suited to their capabilities. And because I've always scrambled around the cliffs, I took on the cliff areas. And the area that we're in at the moment is steep north-facing cliff faces, about maybe 20 foot, and then big ledges or broken slopes in between. It's pretty shaded, and it's absolute fantastic habitat for white beans because they can grow in cracks on vertical cliffs. And because it's northeast facing, it doesn't really dry out. So it's got good capacity for seedlings and saplings to survive. So it's got a whole lot of rare species here. It's a terrible place to find your way around, I can tell you. So I took on this particular area and I found 47 Bristol white beans of various ages and sizes, all the way up this series of terraces and cliffs. And while I was going along, I looked down and thought, good heavens, that looks different. There are about five species of white bean that are only in the Avon Gorge in the world. This is where they began, and the Bristol white bean is one of them. But there are one or two hybrids which haven't really expanded their population. So I'm now talking about one of which there only seems to be one. And it's called after me because I discovered it. It's
Houston's white beam. And some people say, well, aren't you lucky, you know, after you're dead, and you look at it and you think, well, it might die before me. It's not that healthy looking tree, and there is only one of it. So when I discovered it, that year, it was fruiting really well. It had tons and tons of berries. So I thought, I'm going to get to the, if there's only one tree called after me, I'll gather lots of these fruit and give them to botanic gardens and all over the place so that it will not die out. And people can grow on saplings. There'll be a huge population. So I duly did, and I gave loads of fruit to the University Botanic Garden here and elsewhere. And they planted them correctly, and not one single thing came up. So I had this dreadful fear that perhaps it is just a hybrid and that's the end of the story. And after that, it didn't fruit so well. I've seen one lot of fruit down there this year. I'm going to come back and get it when it's ripe.
There's a microclimate here, a degree or so warmer than the surrounding area. It makes the gorge an ideal test bed for investigating how our climate is changing. A study of the climate's effect on plants and bird life has been made by local naturalist Richard Bland. Richard, you've been monitoring plants here since the year 2000. Do your studies show how annual differences in the weather influence when plants come into flower?
Oh yes, indeed. What I decided to do in around 2000, because everyone was interested in climate change, was discover what was the normal date when the wild plants on the gorge came into flower, because there was no information about this. So I do a standard weekly walk and record each week what is in flower. And so I've got the first and indeed the last dates for all the species.
What impact would a permanent change in our climate have on the plants?
A permanent change in the climate would alter the dates at which everything happens. The result of what I've done is that a 1 degree change in temperature leads to something like a 6 day change in the date at which plants come into flower.
Have temperatures fluctuated much over the years?
Yes, a surprising degree. In the past decade, for instance, the temperature of April in 2007 was 4 degrees warmer than the previous year's temperature, which is remarkable. But in the longer term, the climate has altered quite a lot. Climate is an average of 30 years. And in the climate, the spring climate, that's March, April, May, in 1900, was 12.5 degrees. By 1960, this had risen by a whole degree to 13.5 degrees. Surprisingly, it then began to get colder, and it fell by about 0.75 degrees by 1990. Since then, it has, of course, got warmer again. This increase in warming is something that everybody now understands. But people tend to think it's been going on for a long time, whereas, in fact, the spring average temperature is still below what it was in 1960 in Bristol.
The Avon Gorge sustains a rich variety of wildlife, remarkably close to urban Bristol. As a nation, we love birds. Perhaps they remind us of a more rural past. But how does such a dramatic landscape so close to the city centre affect the birds?
Well, we've got some marvellous habitat here. The wonderful thing is that you've got the tidal gorge itself with lots of mudflats, and that attracts wading birds and water birds. You've got the cliffs, vertical cliffs on either side, so you get cliff-dwelling birds, and you've got the ancient woodland, particularly on the far side, but a lot of younger woodland on this side, so you get all the woodland species. So you've got a very remarkable group of birds in a very small area.
And do populations change much here?
Bird populations are always changing, nationally and locally. We've got very good account of the birds of this area for the last 100 years. Some that were here 100 years ago have gone, others that weren't here 100 years ago have come. So it's a It's a very changeable population. But it also changes with the seasons. You've got a rather different population in winter than you have in the summer.
We're at the peregrine watch, close to where they nest each year.
When did the peregrines first nest in the gorge?
Well, the earliest records we have are from Queen Elizabeth I's day, when her chief falconer actually bought the manor of Clifton in order to have access to the peregrines that nested here so he could capture the young for falconry. And clearly there was a peregrine area here from then on, right the way up until the Second World War. When that broke out, the Ministry of Defence actually went around the whole country destroying peregrines and their nests in order to make sure they weren't a threat to carrier pigeons. And so nesting died out.
And when did they return?
Well, they returned finally in the 1990s. What had happened was that their population nationally had been destroyed by the various chemicals that were used in the 1950s. Those were outlawed and the population slowly built up. And the first pair came here in the early 1990s. They've been here ever since. And in the last 20 years, they've raised something like 44 young.
Peregrines are very territorial, and there is only one pair breeding in the gorge. Each year, in May, rock climbers descend the cliff face to the peregrine's nest. They find two chicks, but one had died and has been the basis of a meal for its carnivorous sibling. They climb back with the chick and naturalist okay. Ed Druitt examines it.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's one big peregrine chick.
Is it the right size?
Okay. Just get a few photographs. Yeah, it's just about the size. Our first Avon Gorge peregrine chick. It's actually lovely. Okay, so I'm going to put a metal ring on the right leg.
He tags its leg so that it can be identified from a distance as it grows, flies and hunts.
Sorry, the cracking sound is the ring, not the its leg. Okay, I'm going to do a total head now. Just going to weigh her now.
The chick's mother flies around the gorge, then alights in a Leewood's tree to watch from a distance.
Need some ear defenders there. Okay, if you hold your hands underneath the bag, and I've got her. Brilliant, that's all her done. So we'll just get some more photos and then we can pop it back in the bag to 710 grams.
Wow. When this fluffy bundle matures, she will soar up high on warm uplifts, barrel roll, fold her wings half in, and in a near vertical power dive, swoop down on her prey, sometimes reaching a speed of over 200 miles an hour. She is the fastest creature on the planet.
The Avon Gorge provides vivid evidence of the presence of early ancestors. Downstream from the Clifton Suspension Bridge, Nightingale Valley forms a cleft in Lee Woods.
The head of the valley is crowned with an impressive Iron Age hill fort, long hidden by trees and undergrowth. We can see a 7-acre defensive earthwork with clearly defined banks and ditches. Our forebears lived on this promontory, Stoke Lee Camp, from about 350 to 150 BC. And there's another early settlement right opposite, Clifton. The defendable area is this plateau, and the wooded ramparts fall away towards the promenade. Clifton Camp and Stoke Lee, a dramatic matched pair standing sentinel over the gorge.
On the Downs parkland above the gorge, this trace of a Roman road aligns Bath with a Roman port on the Avon, Portus Aboni. We're back at Sea Mills again. In the 3rd century, this was a small port with maintained streets, drainage systems and public buildings.
Nowadays, only local street names give a hint, but a community of more than 20 acres serviced the Roman legionary fortress of Caerleon across the Severn in Wales. Unearthed here is this altar from the 2nd or 3rd century, thought to be dedicated to the twin powers of sky and ocean. An appropriate dedication at a port on the boundary of these two realms.
The fall of the Roman Empire and attacks by pirates put an end to the Roman port at Sea Mills. Then, in 850 AD, Saxons built a trading settlement upstream from the gorge's towering cliffs at the confluence of two rivers. The settlement was just here, on a narrow spit of land where the rivers Avon and Frome originally met, close by the present Bristol Bridge.
For some miles to the east, much of the land was marshy and flood-prone, but here the ground rose and was safe. And here in Brigstow, ships found shelter against those marauding Danish and Turkish raiders who wouldn't risk the river's unrelenting tides and the gorge's high cliffs that could be so easily defended.
The Avon Gorge created Bristol and protected it. The city grew over the centuries and spilled out over its medieval walls. Suburbs spread in every direction, except the northwest. The Avon Gorge is a permanent physical boundary, a spectacular natural landmark, and a priceless asset for Bristol.